Hello and welcome to part 2 of my Left 4 Dead 2 mapping tutorial series. Today we'll be getting into optimization. Optimization refers to the process of using a handful of techniques the source engine provides with the purposes of increasing frame rates, decreasing file size, and decreasing compile times of your map. It's an important topic, so listen up. We'll be going over how the source engine handles optimization and various techniques you can use to optimize. That being hint brushes, the skybox, funk underscore detail, Nodraw, Areaportals, Occluders, Lightmap scales, and draw distance. To get started with optimization, we need to understand how the source engine actually works. As said in the previous video, a source map needs to be sealed away from the void, and thus, a map, even if it appears to be a giant open space, is basically a series of rooms connected to each other. Open space in these rooms consists of visleaves, which is a hollow volume in a map which defines visible surfaces within it. Visleaves are shaped around brushes in your map. The compiler has three executables it runs to create the map, VBSP, VViz, and VRAD. VViz handles optimization. When you compile your map, it automatically dictates what can and cannot be seen from different positions in your map based on the visleaves it creates. This is called a potentially visible set, but most of the time, VViz does not do a good enough job at determining what you can see, and I can demonstrate this with an example map, shaped like a bracket, with cones on the floor to indicate what's visible. To debug and fix poor optimization, we'll need a few console commands. The first one is mat underscore wireframe 1. I recommend making a toggleable bind to this console command. My bind is listed on the screen now. Now that mat wireframe is on, we can see that even behind a wall, everything on the other side of the wall is being rendered. To understand why this is happening, we need to use another console command, mat underscore leafviz 1 and 3. Setting it to 1 shows only the current visleaf we are standing in, and setting it to 3 shows all the currently rendered visleaves in the map. Mat underscore leafviz 3 shows that we have 3 visleaves shaped like this. The shaded visleaves have line of sight to each other, meaning while the player is in these visleaves, they will always render what's in the opposing visleaf, even if the player themselves can't physically see it. And we can fix it by using hint and skip textures. Hint splits visleaves and skip is ignored by the compiler. We need to use both to make a hint brush. Start by selecting the tool skip texture and make a brush that goes down the main connecting hallway, making sure one face is parallel and flush with the entrances to the two side halls. Select the tool's hint texture and apply it to that one parallel face. Only apply the hint texture to any faces you want to split visleaves, otherwise use skip. This will manually split a visleaf down the entrance to the two side halls, and we can see the results of that in-game. With mat underscore wireframe 1, we can see that we're now no longer rendering the other hallway. We can see our hint brush working by going back and forth where it would be in the editor. We can get even better results by using a hint brush angled 45 degrees to the corner of the entrance to the side hallway, like so. A classic mapping blunder is to surround the entire map with a giant hollow skybox brush. Now you may think you're smart for doing this, since you'll never have a leak, but let's see how it looks in game. Looks pretty good. This is not good. We can see the trees all the way at the other side of the map. They're blocked by multiple walls and separated by multiple corridors, yet they're still being rendered. We can fix this by simply making the skybox adhere to the boundaries of the map. I've made my changes and in-game you can see the trees are no longer being rendered from this position. But it's not just in-game performance that's ruined, it's your compile times as well. Here's a comparison of compile time lengths. One map has a lazy hollow skybox and the other has a properly made and fitted skybox. I think you get the point. Complex brushwork is a nightmare for VViz. Take for example this high polygon cylinder. Turning on mat underscore leafviz 3 reveals that it has a ton of visleaves around it that serve no purpose. We can fix this by using funk underscore detail. Funk detail is a brush entity, meaning that it's made up of brushes, rather than an entity that you spawn with the entity tool. Funk detail is ignored by VViz, so it is extremely useful to lower compile times when used on complex geometry. However, unlike the other techniques I go over in this video, funk detail does not necessarily increase performance. It purely is used to reduce compile times. We can turn the cylinder into a funk detail by selecting it and pressing Ctrl plus T. When making a brush entity, it automatically defaults to funk detail, so we're done here. Compiling and viewing in game shows the cylinder no longer creates useless visleaves around it. An important thing to note about Funk Detail is that since it's ignored by VViz, it does not seal away the void, and you can't use hint brushes around it. In fact, no brush entities seal, so keep that in mind when using them. If you want to change a Funk Detail or any other brush entity back into a normal brush, just press the Two World button at the right. The next and most simple form of optimization is using the Nodraw texture. Nodraw is pretty straightforward. You texture it on a brush and it doesn't render that face in game. If you have brush faces outside of visibility to players in normal circumstances, without cheats, then texturing those brush faces with Nodraw is a no-brainer. The Nodraw texture can also seal the void, even though it's invisible. The third method of optimization we'll be going over is Funk underscore Area Portal, and its brother Funk underscore Area Portal Window. These two entities are powerful methods of optimization but require a bit of setting up. They only render what is seen through the area portal, so they're incredibly useful in doorways where optimization is tight. They do many calculations per second to work, so you should only use them when necessary. To make a Funk area portal, make a brush with the tool's area portal texture. Turn into a brush entity with Control plus T. On the line that says class, type in Funk underscore area portal. There are a couple settings here you can utilize, but they're not necessary for our application. Now put the brush in a place that would make sense. You want to put these in spots that would benefit from culling out a lot of unnecessarily rendered stuff, so doorways and windows are the best candidates for an area portal. With great power comes great responsibility. Area portals must properly fit any hole they can occupy, or else they cause area portal leaks. Along with this, one side of the area portal must not be able to reach the other side. Similarly to sealing the void, area portals need to seal whatever parts of the map they cover. If you have a room with two entrances, both entrances of the room must have area portals at their entrances to prevent area portal leaks. Hey, I hear you cry. My area portal fits the doorway, but it's still leaking. That's probably because the doorway you're trying to fit it in is made out of Funk underscore detail or some other brush entity. I will repeat, as stated previously, no brush entity can seal. This applies to any optimization technique and sealing the void. Funk underscore area portal window functions the exact same as Funk underscore area portal, except when paired with a Funk underscore brush entity, can completely seal everything behind it. At a desired range, the area portal window starts to fade into the Funk brush, and once the brush is fully opaque, nothing behind the area portal window is rendered. Extremely useful to hide stuff inside doorways and windows at a distance. Begin by making a brush with the area portal texture like before, and turn it into a Funk underscore area portal window entity with Control plus T. Next, press Control plus C to copy the area portal window, and press Control plus Shift plus V to open the paste special window. This window allows us to paste objects in desired locations relative to where it was copied. We're gonna leave it blank and press OK, so that it pastes a duplicate of the area portal window right on top of the original. In the properties of the duplicated area portal window, change its class from Funk underscore area portal window to Funk underscore brush. This Funk brush is what we'll use to fade out the area portal window. For most use cases, the Funk brush should be textured with tools black, but it's not a requirement. Give the Funk brush a name, like Portal Window 1. In the area portal window's properties, change the rendered window key value to the name of the Funk brush, in this case, Portal Window 1. The fade start and end distance values are self-explanatory. They dictate when the area portal window should start and end its fade out. In-game and up close to the area portal window, it functions like a normal area portal, but once we walk further away, we can see it slowly fade into our Funk brush. Matte wireframe 1 shows that nothing is being rendered behind it. Opposite to area portals, we have Funk underscore Occluder. Funk Occluder is much more simple to use, but it's a bit less practical. Funk Occluder blocks every model behind it. It doesn't cause any leaks, and similarly to area portals, are expensive to use, so use occluders wisely. To make an occluder, start by making a brush textured with a Nodraw texture, and texture the side you want things to occlude with the tool's occluder texture. Then, press Ctrl plus T and turn the brush into a Funk underscore occluder entity. Funk occluder only blocks things behind it when players look at the brush face with the occluder texture, so if you want an occluder to block both ways, as you likely would, you would need to texture both sides of the Funk occluder entity with the occluder texture, not just one. One optimization technique that is typically neglected and forgotten about is optimizing lightmap scales. In Hammer, in the top left of the 3D viewport is a black text box that says Camera. Click it and select 3D Lightmap Grid. This will turn every brush face into a white grid with blue lines. These are lightmaps. When compiling, VRAD, the lighting executable, uses these grids to determine the brush face's lighting resolution. In-game, if you look hard enough, you can make out the scale of the light map on a brush face. To change the brush's light map scale, select a face with the face edit sheet open, and change the light map scale value near the top right of the panel. Lower equals more resolution, and vice versa. So what does this have to do with optimization? Well, most of a map's file size is dictated by the scale of these light maps, and we could significantly reduce it by optimizing them. Additionally, optimizing light maps significantly reduces compile times. It's fair to say light maps are very important to optimize. No one likes to spend hours compiling their maps, and no one wants to download a multi-gigabyte map. Optimizing your light maps takes a really long time and a lot of manual labor, so doing it when the map is complete prevents having to do it again if a map needs revisioning. And a fully complete map allows you to see what light map scales need changing and which don't. If a brush is completely shrouded in darkness or has no contrasting shadows, you could get away with setting the light map scale really high, like 128. If a brush has vast contrasting shadows, it's best to keep these light map scales unchanged, or even lower, to preserve or enhance detail. All of it will be worth it in the end when your map compiles quickly and its file size is low. Draw distance is probably the most common optimization technique used in video games, and it finds its way into source as well. In this example map, you can see that as I walk away from these props, the bench and trash can are barely visible. We can get away with setting a fade distance on them to save performance. In the prop entity's properties, look for start fade distance and end fade distance. The start value determines when the prop will begin to fade out, and the end value determines when the prop is fully faded out and no longer rendered. Again, like light maps, it's best to wait to do this when your map is fully detailed and lit up, so you can see which props are obscured by other detail or dim lighting. Particularly for Left 4 Dead 2, tanks can throw props around like physics dumpsters and cars. So if you have these in your map, either set the fade distance to be really high or have none at all. Here's what happens when you have a tank throw a dumpster at you with a fade distance of 200. You can also set a draw distance for the entire playable map, with an EMV underscore fog underscore controller entity. This entity creates fog in your map and allows you to change the color and distance of it, by enabling the fog, setting a color, and setting the start and end values respectively. The farz clip plane parameter controls the distance at which the entire map is cold around the player, in hammering units. Work this parameter in tandem with your choice of fog color and skybox to get a subtle performance boost. Don't choose a red fog color with a blue skybox, try to make it match. Most default Left 4 Dead 2 maps have very thick and close fog to mask this abrupt culling, so take some inspiration from there. This concludes the second video of my Left 4 Dead 2 mapping tutorial series. Making a map run good is almost as important as making the map fun. I highly recommend not to jump in and make a wide open forest as your first map, for example. Optimizing maps for source is a skill that develops over time. Next video will be a short one about clipping. Thank you for watching.